I have invited Massimo Visconti for two reasons. First of all, he was part of the integration team in this joint venture
many years ago,
so he knows from an outside and inside the development of your company. And second, I would like also to talk about generally about the industry. Maybe Massimo, I know it's a bit difficult for you because somehow you are still colored with this joint venture. What is your external professional perception? How well did Angelini and Procter & Gamble this joint venture first? And how do you see these three key USPs, as Roberto said, sustainability, innovation, 360 degree approach, is this just a marketing blah blah, or they are really that good and better than their competitors?
It's a good tough question because I cannot say nothing that's true because otherwise
Roberto
blame me.
You are not paid by them, so.
Okay, first of all, what Roberto said about the joint venture process is something really unique. Because I remember initially there were a lot of question mark about the kind of real sustainability of this business model. Because let's imagine that from one side you have a big multinational company suffering a lot in terms of competition vis-a-vis this quote-unquote small family-owned company. And this was a lot of question how we can survive, because at that time all the profit coming from the main brand, that was Dash, was using, Roberto, say yes or not, in order to support the Pampers business. And this is not a sustainable process in the long run. Yeah. So when they decide as a Procter & Gamble to approach the Angelini family in order to find this solution, it was something very strange because the 50-50 share model doesn't work anywhere. In terms of professional experience, I have other experience with other multinational companies that tried to make the same approach. It was a disaster. And the disaster was led by, let's say, untrust, let's say, credibility.
Why do you think they succeed this very particular joint venture? Is because of Roberto, because he's that good as a CEO. What was the reason in aspects of a technical point of view?
Okay, Roberto is a friend of mine, so it's difficult to say something about that. Is the right person in the right position. I mean, is the last one. I had the opportunity to see other P&G and the Angelini former CEO, someone acting very well, some other, from my perspective, had some problem in managing this strangest joint venture. So the learning is that in order to run in the right proper way this, let's say, unusual position, for me, first of all, you have to, in this particular situation, you have to put on the table all the, let's say, heritage coming from Procter & Gamble. That is very structured, very process-oriented, very fair.
Let me talk afterwards about his leadership style, and let's go to the sector in general. Well, I can imagine fast-moving consumer goods, it's not directly related to the financial crisis we had over the last, or structural crisis, or political crisis, whatever crisis it was over the last 7-8 years. How do you see generally the development of the fast-moving consumer goods over the last years, and where is fast-moving consumer goods today, and what's the trend over the future?
Okay, let's talk about more or less of a global market of 80 billion euros. So it's a big market that is living, starting before the crisis, I mean, starting the first half of the second decade of the century, from Central Europe interest to somewhere interest. I mean, somewhere is Asia, Pacific, and something like this. So to all what we call emerging markets. It means that this business is a strange animals. I mean, from one side you have to maintain the traditional characteristics. From other side you have to let's say, understanding the different consumer behavior and the different market behavior that is emerging during this day. On top of that, we have the crisis. The crisis affects a lot of the consumer, so we are can say now that this is a typical aspect of the shift value. I mean, consumers now are more smarter than when I was in Procter & Gamble my time.
They're better informed, they have
Google. Better informed, is a digital consumer, so they can compare pricing, offering, and so on and so forth. Is more educated, is looking for more, let's say, sustainable solution, and they want to see through.
So you are saying that selling today fast-moving consumer goods, it's harder than before?
Absolutely, yes.
How do you see the differences in aspects of behavior, attitude, comportment in Asia or Latin America and Africa compared to Europe? Are these Procter & Gamble's and Father's or Angelini's doing the same approach in these countries, or is just an upgraded version to distribute their products?
What I'm saying is my personal point of view, but I imagine that Procter & Gamble cannot apply the same approach that, for example, Procter & Gamble has in North America to China or to Morocco or whatever you want in terms of the emerging market.
What are the, just to close this industrial topic, what are the key three challenges the industry has, and what are the key three trends? I would like to ask Roberto, might be the compact to you. Roberto, from your side, because you are operational inside this business, what are the three challenges your industry is facing, and what are the three market trends you see over the next, let me say, 4 or 5 years?
If I look at the challenges, I look at the challenges not necessarily from the standpoint of global perspective. I look at the challenges from our point of view, which is really a company that is has created in Italy a good position, and now is trying to look outside of Italy, and therefore my point of perspective could be slightly different. And my point of perspective is the following. Number one is our markets, especially for a company operating mostly in the developed world, are markets that are no longer growing, and in many cases are declining. Think about the baby diapers, and think about the aging population in many parts of the West Europe. So one challenge is that how do you beat that market decline trend? The second challenge is that if we look at the composition of the market, the trade customers' composition is changing significantly, and in this change there is important implication for industry that produce brands. The change is clearly in many ways driven by some consumer trends, but it has been amplified because what we see in many places is the development of discounters and the development of customers that are driving more and more their own business model that foresees their own brand, their own private labels, and to the detriment of brands. That has been typically the discounters model, that whilst has gone through some changes, still remains a model that favors everyday low price, their own private labels, and clearly disadvantages the rest of the brand industry. And the third drive is the real change in the consumer habits, and especially in a way in which consumers decide which products to use and decide which way he or she wants to relate with a company that makes those products. I think we need to be much more factual in the way we talk to them. Irrespective of the media that we use, we could use digital media, we could use broadcast media, we can use anything. I think what is happening more and more is that he, she needs to be much more informed about our products. And that relates to the benefits of the product, but also the origin of the products, the sustainability, the inherent impact that we have on the products. That really creates a whole host of new challenges for us. And sometimes those challenges are different country by country. And I want to go back to something that I think you and Massimo said at the very end of the last question, which is, you know, what father would do in Senegal or wherever. One of the things that keeps me awake during night is that creating a business model as we go abroad has to relate with building on our strengths. My father has many strengths, has you know, clearly a strong belief of innovation, a strong I think advantage in our ability to go to the market with our sales force. We have a strong capability in the supply chain. And I think our challenge is how do we leverage those capabilities in markets and even accepting a different execution in different markets. I believe that if father behaves like a micro multinational, we are going to lose, because clearly we face in those markets where we are expanding incredible companies, some really strong, powerful, capable multinational companies. And if we try to imitate them, we're not going to go anywhere.
I think, Roberto, at the end of the day, it's not only the success about the products, it's about the people. Okay, and it's about leadership. Let me just come to you, because you have been presented by Massimo, who knows you from different areas as an exceptional leader. What are your essentials? What are your beliefs in aspects of leadership? What have you done to get there? Maybe some mistakes we should avoid. What are your recommendations? Because this program is about leadership. So I'm talking to you as a leader. And I think, what are your essentials of your leadership, which we can take as a good benchmark? How you get there? Why you are there? Why you have made this company successful?
You know, in terms of leadership, I probably tend to be quite maybe an atypical leader. I don't know.
Roberto, were you born as a leader, or did you became a leader?
No, I don't think I was born a leader. I was. Well, I really believe that you know, everybody has different characteristics, and put in a certain circumstances, one can behave at its best, and then you can be a strong leader in certain circumstances. And I think I've been lucky enough, because you know, I had my career in P&G. You know, I come from a background. I studied philosophy, you know, at the university. I have nothing to do with business. And thankfully, I joined P&G, who learned me everything about the business. But you know, in terms of my leadership style, I would say I like to work with people and in a company where we act as a group of friends. We are very open, even brutal, but we have respect for each other. We like each other, and we are able to mix work and fun. And that is what I try to recreate, specifically in Father. That was, I think, important, because I came from outside, and I didn't have, nobody knew me. I didn't have, you know, reputation or whatever, because, you know, I didn't work with any of these people. So it took me time before they started to see me as a leader, because I believe that, and that's the second part of what I like on leaders, is the leader needs to really be close to the people, and that is the first part. The second part is that the leaders need to be competent.
I really appreciate your insight. I think it has been very helpful to understand this joint venture, and also the modus operandi from you as a leader, and also obviously from Massimo Visconti, who has two hearts, or two souls, the consultant and the ones operational of this joint venture. I think has been a very good insight. I would like to thank you, Roberto, for your time.
Thank you. Time.
I wish you a continuous good leadership and a continuous good development of Father. Good success. And also Massimo for having been here. Thanks a
good
lot.
To you.
This was Inside Business, talking about the trend in fast-moving consumer goods, having guests like the CEO of Father SPA and Massimo Visconti, who is the Managing Director of the Fast Moving Consumer Good at IMC International. Thanks for watching. See you next.